What if I told you that A plus B doesn't equal B plus A, and that we're about to violate the laws of mathematics? Well, let's take the infinite series shown here. From telescoping the terms in this series, we can tell that the series is going to converge to zero. Now let's do some basic manipulation of the series by moving some terms around. I'm going to take the first two positive terms of the series and follow it by the first negative, and continue that pattern until we get a series that looks like this. With a couple parentheses here and there, and some simplification, we are left with a series that looks like this, an awfully familiar-looking series. Actually, this is the alternating harmonic series, which converges to the natural log of 2. So, does that mean that 0 equals the natural log of 2? I mean, in middle school, we're taught that a plus b equals b plus a, the commutative property of addition. But that property is clearly violated with this scenario. So, what's going on? Did we break math? Welcome to the Riemann Rearrangement Theorem. Though we mainly know Riemann for his wonderful ways to estimate integrals and his zeta function, Riemann also had some contributions he wanted to make to the world of infinite series. The theorem states that, suppose that A of n is a sequence of real numbers, and A of n is conditionally convergent. Let S be a real number. There exists a permutation sigma such that the sum of A sigma of n to infinity is equal to S. There also exists a permutation sigma so that the sum is equal to infinity. The sum can also be arranged to diverge to negative infinity or to fail to approach any limit, finite or infinite. In more human words, Riemann is saying that if your series is composed of real numbers and converges conditionally, you can rearrange the terms of the series in any way you want to be equal to any real number, or equal nothing at all and diverge to the depths of infinity. How is that possible? How about we go through the proof for this theorem together, and we can determine whether or not this defies the laws of mathematics. For simplicity, we're assuming that a of n does not equal 0 for any n in the series. Let's use our friend the alternating harmonic series for this proof. First, we're going to define two quantities, a of n positive and a of n negative. A of n positive can be written as a of n plus the absolute value of a of n divided by 2, which leaves us with all of the positive terms of the series, with the negative terms replaced by zeros. A of n negative can be written as a of n minus the absolute value of a of n divided by 2, which makes a series with all the negative terms of a of n and the positive ones replaced by zeros. We can tell through the p-series test that both of these new series derived from the original a of n will diverge, but we can also determine their divergence from the fact that a of n is conditionally convergent. Basically, what we're saying here is that the positive terms of a of n diverge to positive infinity, and the negative terms of a of n diverge to negative infinity, but when they're put together, they converge to a single sum. Now, let S represent a positive real number, let's say 2. Let's take enough positive terms from a of n so that their sum exceeds S, and let's say that we need p terms for this, in this case, p equals 8. Now we can say that S of p is greater than S. It will always be possible for a partial sum of any of the positive terms of a of n to exceed any value of s, because a of n positive diverges to positive infinity. Now, we're going to add enough of the first negative terms of a of n, let's say q terms, to get the partial sum to be below s, which means that s of p plus q is less than s. Once again, we are able to do this with the negative terms because, as we've already established, the negative terms of a of n diverge to negative infinity, a fact that guarantees the decreasing of the sum with the addition of more negative terms. We can continue the process of adding positive terms to exceed s and adding negative terms to get the partial sum less than s, and we will begin to notice that all of these partial sums differ from s by at most one positive or negative term. These partial sums must be closing in on s. Since the original series a of n converges, its terms a of n go to zero as n goes to infinity. We can get as close to s as we want within any epsilon, aka any infinitesimal small quantity or error. And if we go far enough into the series to where all the remaining terms have an absolute value less than epsilon, we don't have to rearrange the series in the pattern outlined in the proof, where we go just above s and then just below it. You can seriously overshoot your target sum and go way above or below it in the positive or negative direction. But as long as you eventually reach a point where you are oscillating between somewhere close above s and somewhere close below it, you are guaranteed that sum s. You can also make the series diverge if you wanted to. If you lined up about a million positive terms, followed by a single negative term, and continue that pattern into infinity, then I think it's safe to say that that series is just going to diverge. So the question is, does 0 really equal the natural log of 2? And does this theorem violate everything we've learned in mathematics up to this point? Not really. We just have to remember that infinite series do not behave the same way as finite ones do. And, as we saw from the proof, there are many components to conditionally convergent series that allow it to behave in such a way. Math isn't broken or anything, it's just beautifully complex and has nuances that we can appreciate.